Hello, this is Dr. Ed Park from Recharge Biomedical Clinic, and I'd like to talk to you about chromosome damage and its relationship to telomeres. If you go through to PubMed and type in telomerase or telomere, you'll get 13,000 articles, although if you ask your doctor, they might not even have heard of telomeres or telomerase, despite winning the Nobel Prize last year for the discovery of telomerase. Well, we're going to remedy that situation for you, and we're going to show you that there's a lot of exciting research going on. This first article, 2010, showing brain cancer or glioblastoma related to telomere damage. Here, prostate cancer, and you can freeze these and check the citations if you'd like. Here, lung cancer. And finally, in the prestigious Journal of the American Medical Association, a review article in July showing that people with long telomeres were more protected, but people with short telomeres had a 22 out of 1,000 person year chance of cancer, with twice the mortality associated. Also of interest, Alzheimer's has been related to poor telomere maintenance, as well as heart attack and stroke, this coming from July 2010. Well, how could this possibly be? How could one process be associated with so many different problems? Well, the answer lies in the fact that every cell needs to divide, and they have these end caps made from telomeres, which prevent the ends from being recognized as DNA damage. But with cell division comes shortening of each telomere by replicative senescence, which will be discussed in a different lecture. And this is bad. When the telomeres get critically short, they can activate pathways, which hopefully will repair the DNA, but if not, that cell will need to be killed. This diagram shows a lot of ways that cells can be killed or halted. Primarily, if you have breaks, it can trigger ATM or ATR protein, which act in various ways to stimulate P53, the watchman, and these checkpoint mechanisms are triggered, preventing the cell from this critical transition from G2 phase to M phase. What are phases? Well, the cell cycle is composed of G1, which is just a regular cell, and if it's a regular cell that doesn't want to copy itself, it's even in G0. Liver cells, for example, can maybe copy once or twice. But in the rest of your body, there's 50 billion cell divisions, which is essentially taking one cell and dividing it into two daughters. In order to do that, it has to pass this checkpoint, the restriction checkpoint, which tells us that the chromosome number is correct. It goes through S, or synthesis duplication, and in G2, there are two copies of chromosomes. Prior to entering mitosis, or division into two daughters, there's another checkpoint here to make sure all the DNA is copied, and also that in G2 all the proteins and RNA that make up the epigenetic or cell differentiation information is okay. Also, in mitosis, there's a critical step here called the spindle activation checkpoint. Here's a spindle, pulling your chromosomes apart, 23 to this side, 23 to this daughter. So, I'm sorry, it's 46 to one daughter, 46 to the other. So what's that all about? Well, as you may recall, chromosomes come in pairs. There should be pairs like this, number 1 through 22, and then the X and the Y. And what happens if the separation is faulty? Well, in general, the separation is monitored by the spindle activation or assembly checkpoint. Anyway, if the spindles are all lined up with good tension, the checkpoint is off. They can be cut, 46, 46, two daughters, everything's fine. But if the tethers are not taut and they're not even, then the checkpoint or the waiting mechanism is in place, and that inhibits this division until and unless the chromosome numbers are correct for bequeathing to each daughter. But there are other translocation events that can happen when the cells are all lined up like this. Here are some common ones that maybe one would go to this arm of 11, causing schizophrenia, or perhaps Down syndrome from here to there, Ewing sarcoma from 22 to 11. And what does that look like? Well, here's what that looks like. Here, blue has switched with yellow. One has gone to 4. Now, these kinds of switches are infinite in their possibilities, but here are just some syndromes which occur because these sequences are kind of similar and they maybe would have the tendency to cross over. If the wrong number of chromosomes crosses over, you can get 3, you can get 1, you can get 0. This is all bad. There should be 23 equal pairs colored without these other colored stripes. So it's like having two trapeze artists. If their hands are crazy glued and they're being pulled apart, well, guess what? Something else is going to break, and you can get these kind of problems. So what does this have to do with anything? Well, in closing, we'll look at what the uncapping of the chromosomes can achieve. Here they're uncapped, and maybe they're not in that nifty little T-loop formation that we have come to rely upon here. Well, the cell will recognize this as a DNA damage, and ATR protein will be generated. P53 will keep the cell from going into the next phase of the cycle, and it just buys time so that the cell can start repairing using mechanisms such as BRCA1 and FANCD. So these things are all conspiring to actually repair errors. Here we see an example of an experiment done by Maria Blasco in Spain, where she took mice without the ability to make telomerase, and she introduced it genetically, which had the result of dropping the number of critically short telomeres, probably in this manner. When she gave the mice telomerase, signal-free ends dropped precipitously, rings dropped, end-to-end fusions went to 0, as did end-to-end fusions in the absence of a telomere signal. So, what is an end-to-end fusion? An end-to-end fusion is when the ends are not properly capped. The DNA repair mechanisms think that it's an error that needs to be spliced. It does so, and thereby creating this double chromosome, like our trapeze artists. That's bad. Now, activating telomerase may be something like repairing a stripped screw. This Phillips head is no longer an X, you can't get it out of there. But if you're able to lengthen telomeres, what happens is P53 can come in and perhaps kill them, if not the other checkpoints. So, although DNA errors are inevitable, as are chromosome errors, there are mechanisms in place to take care of that. This final diagram shows the Hayflick limit, which is the basic theory or the fact that if cells divide indefinitely without telomerase activity, they will die off. And part of that reason is probably because the growth of the aneuploid fraction, or the percentage of these abnormal cells, goes up. Just like car parts, if you use them long enough, they'll break down. Or just like photocopies, if you copy from photocopies enough, you're going to get errors. Here's a small cell carcinoma of the lung, again with the crossovers that we saw. Here's a regular adenocarcinoma of the lung. 3 copies of 8, 3 of 14, 4 of 20, 1 of 6. These are all bad things. And of course, you can quickly appreciate that the number of ways in which they cross over or get aneuploid, meaning too much or too little of one copy, it's really infinite. This is Dr. Ed Park, and I'm completing a lecture on chromosome damage and why it's important to prevent with telomerase activation. I hope you found this interesting, and if so, please tell a friend, and you can also go to the blog to keep up to date with other postings and other news related to telomerase activation. Here you can sign up for our newsletter and you will be the first to receive any new postings. Thanks for your attention.